You're listening to the audio production of Searching for Sunday, Loving, Leaving, and Finding the Church by Rachel Held Evans, published by Thomas Nelson and read by the author.
Searching for Sunday, Loving, Leaving, and Finding the Church by Rachel Held Evans. To Amanda, the little sister I look up to, and the person who makes me most hopeful about the future of the church. And to the community on the blog, I wrote every word of this book for you. Epigraph. I prefer a church which is bruised, hurting, and dirty because it has been out on the streets, rather than a church which is unhealthy from being confined and from clinging to its own security. More than by fear of going astray, my hope is that we will be moved by the fear of remaining shut up within structures which give us a false sense of security, within rules which make us harsh judges, within habits which make us feel safe, while at our door people are starving, and Jesus does not tire of saying to us, "Give them something to eat." Pope Francis. Prologue. Dawn. I'll tell you how the sun rose a ribbon at a time. Emily Dickinson. German theologian Dietrich Bonhoeffer wrote that the early mornings belong to the Church of the Risen Christ. At the break of light, it remembers the morning on which death and sin lay prostrate in defeat, and new life and salvation were given to mankind. This comes as unfortunate news for someone like me who can barely remember who she is at the break of light, much less ponder the theological implications of the resurrection. I'm not exactly what you call a morning person and would in fact prefer to be the one lying prostrate in defeat at such an early hour. The halcyon joy of watching the sunrise remains for me just another one of the universe's inaccessible gifts, like the northern lights and naturally curly hair. No doubt I would have shooed poor Mary Magdalene away with a soft, pillow-muffled grunt had she asked me to help her bring the burial spices to the tomb that fateful morning 2,000 years ago. I'd have slept right through the main event. Religious folks have always had it out for us night owls. My Book of Hours stipulates that morning prayers be said between 4:30 and 7:30 a.m. How I'm supposed to talk to God at an hour in which I cannot even speak coherently to my husband is beyond me. Yet nearly all of the church's most venerated saints were said to be early risers. And growing up, I remember pastors speaking reverently about their morning quiet times, as though God kept strict office hours. Even the world's great cathedrals are built with their entrances on the west side and their altars on the favored east. Old European churchyards, dappled with wind-abraded headstones, still reflect the custom of burying the dead with their feet toward the rising sun, as a sign of hope, and with the expectation that when Jesus returns to Jerusalem at the second coming, the faithful will rise and look him in the eye. One can only hope this will happen sometime after 9 o'clock in the morning, Eastern Standard Time. If early mornings indeed belong to the church, then my generation is sleeping in. In the United States, 59% of young people ages 18 to 29 with a Christian background have dropped out of church. Among those of us who came of age around the year 2000, a solid quarter claim no religious affiliation at all, making us significantly more disconnected from faith than members of Generation X were at a comparable point in their lives, and twice as disconnected as baby boomers were as young adults. It is estimated that 8 million young adults will leave the church before their 30th birthday. At 32, I only just qualify as a millennial. Let's just say I still have several episodes of Friends saved on tape. But despite having one foot in Generation X, I tend to identify most strongly with the attitudes and ethos of the millennial generation. And because of this, I'm often asked to speak to church leaders about why young adults are leaving the church. One could write volumes around that question, and indeed many have. I can't speak exhaustively about the social and historical currents that shape American religious life, or about the forces that draw so many of my peers away from faith altogether. The issues that haunt American evangelicalism are different than those that haunt mainline Protestants, which are different than those that affect Catholic and Episcopal parishes, which are different than those influencing Christianity in the parts of the world where it is actually flourishing, namely the global South and East. But I can tell my own story, which studies suggest is an increasingly common one. I can talk about growing up evangelical, about doubting everything I believed about God, about loving, leaving, and longing for church, about searching for it and finding it in unexpected places. And I can share the stories of my friends and readers, people young and old, whose comments, letters, and emails read like postcards from their own spiritual journeys, dispatches from America's post-Christian frontier. I can't provide the solutions church leaders are looking for, but I can articulate the questions that many in my generation are asking. I can translate some of their angst, some of their hope. At least that's what I tried to do when I was recently asked to explain to 3,000 evangelical youth workers gathered together for a conference in Nashville, Tennessee, why millennials like me are leaving the church. I told them we're tired of the culture wars, tired of Christianity getting all entangled with party politics and power. Millennials want to be known what we're for, I said, not just what we're against. We don't want to choose between science and religion or between our intellectual integrity and our faith. Instead, we long for our churches to be safe places to doubt, to ask questions, and to tell the truth, even when it's uncomfortable. We want to talk about the tough stuff, biblical interpretation, religious pluralism, sexuality, racial reconciliation, and social justice, but without predetermined conclusions or simplistic answers. We want to bring our whole selves through the church doors, without leaving our hearts and minds behind, without wearing a mask. I explained that when our gay, lesbian, bisexual, and transgender friends aren't welcome at the table, then we don't feel welcome either, and that not every young adult gets married or has children, so we need to stop building our churches around categories and start building them around people. And I told them that, contrary to popular belief, we can't be won back with hipper worship bands, fancy coffee shops, or pastors who wear skinny jeans. We millennials have been advertised to our entire lives, so we can smell BS from a mile away. The church is the last place we want to be sold another product, the last place we want to be entertained. Millennials aren't looking for a hipper Christianity, I said. We're looking for a truer Christianity, a more authentic Christianity. Like every generation before ours and every generation after, we're looking for Jesus. The same Jesus who can be found in the strange places he's always been found. In bread, in wine, in baptism, in the word, in suffering, in community, and among the least of these. No coffee shops or fog machines required. Of course, I said all of this from the center of a giant stage equipped with lights, trampolines, and indeed a fog machine. I'm never entirely comfortable at these events, not because my words are unwelcome or untrue, but because I feel so out of my depth delivering them. I'm not a scholar or statistician. I've never led a youth group or pastored a congregation. The truth is, I don't even bother getting out of bed many Sunday mornings, especially on the days when I'm not sure I believe in God, or when there's an interesting guest on Meet the Press. For me, talking about church in front of a bunch of Christians means approaching a microphone and attempting to explain the most important, complicated, beautiful, and heart-wrenching relationship of my life in 30 minutes or less, without yelling or crying or saying any cuss words. Sometimes I wish they'd find someone with a bit more emotional distance to give these lectures. Someone who doesn't have to break herself open and bleed all over the place every time someone asks, innocently enough, So where have you been going to church these days? Perhaps this is why I didn't want to write this book, at least not at first. Oh, I tried to get out of it. I hemmed and hawed and pitched a bunch of alternative proposals to my publisher, hoping the editors might change their minds. It took twice as long to write as I'd planned. I even spilled a fat mug of chai all over my laptop right in the middle of writing the first draft, and thinking that I'd lost half the manuscript, decided that God didn't want me to write a book about church either. We were able to recover most of the manuscript, but my caps lock still gets stuck from time to time. I didn't want to put my church story in print because the truth is, I still don't know the ending. I am in the adolescence of my faith. There have been slammed doors and rolled eyes and defiant declarations of "I hate you" hurled at every person or organization that represents the institutionalized church. I am angry and petulant, hopeful and naive. I am trying to make my own way, but I haven't yet figured out how to do that without exercising the old one, without shouting it down, declaring my independence, and then running as fast as I can in the opposite direction. Church books are written by people with a plan and 10 steps, not by Christians just hanging on by their fingernails. And yet, I am writing. I am writing because I suspect the awkward teenager in the yearbook picture still has something to say about the world, some sort of hope to offer it, if nothing more than a few hundred pages of "me too." I am writing because sometimes we are closer to the truth in our vulnerability than in our safe certainties. And because in spite of all my doubt and insecurity, in spite of my abiding impulse to sleep in on Sunday mornings, I have seen the first few ribbons of dawn's light seep through my bedroom window, and there is a dim, hopeful glow kissing the horizon. Even when I don't believe in church, I believe in resurrection. I believe in the hope of Sunday morning. It seemed fitting to arrange the book around the sacraments, because it was the sacraments that drew me back to church after I'd given up on it. When my faith had become little more than an abstraction, a set of propositions to be affirmed or denied, the tangible, tactile nature of the sacraments invited me to touch, smell, taste, hear, and see God in the stuff of everyday life again. They got God out of my head and into my hands. They reminded me that Christianity isn't meant to simply be believed. It's meant to be lived, shared, eaten, spoken, and enacted in the presence of other people. They reminded me that, try as I may, I can't be a Christian on my own. I need a community. I need the church. As Barbara Brown Taylor puts it, in an age of information overload, the last thing any of us needs is more information about God. We need the practice of incarnation, by which God saves the lives of those whose intellectual ascent has turned them dry as dust, who have run frighteningly low on the bread of life, who are dying to know more God in their bodies. Not more about God, more God. So I am telling my church story in 7 sections, through the imagery of baptism, confession, holy orders, communion, confirmation, anointing of the sick, and marriage. These are the 7 sacraments named by Roman Catholic and Orthodox churches, but one need not consider them the church's only sacraments. I could easily write about the sacrament of pilgrimage, the sacrament of foot washing, the sacrament of the word, the sacrament of making chicken casseroles, or any number of outward signs of inward grace. My aim in employing these 7 sacraments is not theological or ecclesiological, but rather literary. They are the tent pegs anchoring my little tabernacle of a story to the ground. I chose them because they have something of a universal quality. For even in churches that are not expressly sacramental, the truths of the sacraments are generally shared. The church tells us we are beloved. Baptism. The church tells us we are broken. Confession. The church tells us we are commissioned. Holy orders. The church feeds us. Communion. The church welcomes us, confirmation. The church anoints us, anointing of the sick. The church unites us, marriage. Of course, the church can also lie, injure, damage, and exclude, and this book explores its dark corners as well as its stained glass splendors. But for a generation that is struggling to make sense of what church is for, I hope these seven mysteries remind us to taste and see that the Lord is good, and to maybe not give up. I hope they remind us of how badly we need one another. I have featured in these pages the stories of churches from a variety of traditions: Baptist, Mennonite, Anglican, Catholic, Pentecostal, non-denominational, and I have drawn heavily from the writings of Christians ranging from Alexander Schmemann, Orthodox, to Nadia Bolz Weber, Lutheran, to Will Willimon, Methodist, to Sarah Miles, Episcopalian. I have included the stories of laypeople and pastors, friends and blog readers, the churched and the unchurched. This is my story, but it is also the story of many others. This book is entitled Searching for Sunday, but it's less about searching for a Sunday church and more about searching for Sunday.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.